Centaur Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Strange Devices of the Sun and Moon by Lisa Goldstein. Narrated by Mary Sarah. A company of ragged knaves, sunbathing beggars, lazy hedge creepers, sleeping face upwards in the fields all night, dream strange devices of the sun and moon. Thomas Nash, Summer's Last Will and Testament. February, 1590. 1. The traveller in front rode a horned mount and had horns on his head as well. He was dressed in green, with soft, dark green boots and a cloak that flowed on behind him. The bells twined in the animal's mane made little sound. Something like the wind blowing somewhere far off. Behind him rode the standard bearers, carrying the old banners stained with dew and rotted with rain. And behind them, the queen. He lifted a trumpet to his lips and blew it, and then turned and motioned to the troop behind him. They followed him like a wave. As they passed through the dark streets, their way was lit by a sparkling light, as if the element they moved in was not air, but fire. If people had seen them pass by, and no one did, though a few looked directly at them, they would have thought of stars falling to earth, and compared to their lights, the stars and the round moon were dull, dimmed by fog and soot, and the candles from houses and inns and taverns. They were going into exile, though none of them mentioned it. Some of the flightier ones had even forgotten it, and now they bent to play with the stones on the city streets, thinking them a sort of toy. "Press on! Press on!" a few of them called, and the ones who had picked up the handfuls quickly dropped them. The company moved through the streets, drawing closer as a defense against the strangeness. Some flew ahead on wings like thin and shining silk, some rode fine horses or birds. Some were small enough to be carried. They who spent so much of their lives in a kind of dream now looked around as if awakening, seeing the huge wooden and plaster houses, the streets wider than any meadow path, the faint stars overhead. Some of them laughed in surprise. A few whimpered for a moment, and then forgot why it was they were supposed to be unhappy. "Press on! Press on!" came the call from the front of the line. And those at the back took it up. Some of them began to sing. In the cold London houses, people stirred in their beds, thinking they heard something. Alice Wood turned and reached for her husband John, forgetting in her sleep that he was dead and in his grave this past year. "It's the wind," she whispered, though to whom she said it, she didn't know. In the taverns, the wits fell silent a moment, and one or two of them made a move to depart. A young man abroad late found himself singing a song he hadn't heard since childhood, and poor Hogg raised his eyes from an experiment and thought, "They're here. They've come at last." Before cockcrow and first light, the travellers dispersed to houses throughout London. A few of them passed the rest of the night sweeping the hearth or mending old clothes. Others curled up in out-of-the-way corners and went to sleep. The queen waited to thank the horned man for bringing them to their destination. They would be safe in this strange place, she thought, by running brook and standing stone, by all the powers of the world. It would go well for them here. By the time she woke, Alice had forgotten the disturbances of the night. She dressed in her skirt and bodice and ruff, and adjusted a small linen cap over her head. Then she took a moment to glance in her small hand mirror. The face that looked back at her seemed, as always, older than she expected, as though somewhere in her mind she was still young and living with John. How had the years passed so quickly? She saw fine blonde hair, too light to show the grey, a wide mouth and high cheekbones, and strangely up-tilted eyes. "Like Tartus," John had said about her eyes, that they were blue instead of brown. It had snowed lightly the day before, but the morning looked to be unseasonably warm for February. Weak sunlight came in through the two windows at the front of the house. As she opened the door to go to work, she noticed the place looked cleaner than usual. Freshly swept, and without thinking about it, she felt strangely gladdened, lighter than she had in days. Her house was along the north wall of St. Paul's on Paternoster Row, and the store from which she sold her books stood in the walled yard of the cathedral itself. The church, to the scandal of the priests and religious people of London, served as the centre and meeting place for nearly everyone in the city. As she headed for her stall, she saw evidence of the day's activity beginning. A tailor jostled past her, scraps of cloth hanging from his shoulder. Near her, someone was posting a bill advertising employment. One of the large London inns seeking a hostler. Scriveners and lawyers, gallants and gossips, were hastening toward the large wooden cathedral. There they would spread out through the aisles and nave, display their wares on the tombs and font, look for clients, ask for and receive the latest news. Almost all the booksellers and painters in London had their station in St. Paul's, either against the church itself or in rows leading away from it. Some of them had already started setting up their wares and were calling to the early browsers. Buy a new book, sir. Here's the latest news from France. Almanacs, almanacs and prognostications. Jigs and ballads here. Honest man, here are the books you lack. Good morning.
Her neighbour at the next door, Edward Blunt, called to her.
Morning, she said, putting her books out on display. She didn't have as many books as Blunt. In the harrowing time after her husband's death, she had been too busy learning the business to acquire any new titles. But John had left her some popular pamphlets and ballads, and she kept the monopoly, which had allowed him to print all the playbills in London. Still, she couldn't help but envying Blunt his impeccable literary taste, his nose for what was both good and popular. More booksellers were opening their stores now. A moneylender walked by, deep in conversation with a client. George Cowper called to her as he passed. Looks to be a fair day, she said to him.
Aye, but it'll probably turn foul later, he said. Care to take your dinner with me?
If I'm not too busy.
Come, you won't be as busy as I will.
Oh, I'll sell a book or two, she said. She liked George, but she wished he wouldn't keep reminding her that his business was brisker than hers. And as if to spite him, she did a good trade all day, with hardly any time at all to rest. The lawyers were in town for the Candlemas term, and she and every other bookseller were kept busy answering questions about the books and news they'd missed while they were out of London. By the time she managed to get away to the stores on Cheapside Street, George had already eaten. More people thronged the churchyard when she got back. In a month or so, it would be warm enough for the playhouses to open. But in late winter, those who wanted to see and be seen came to Paul's. She watched as a man urged his horse through the crowd and into the cathedral, which was used as a shortcut for those who didn't want to walk the long way around the walls. Two dogs fought over a scrap of meat, and someone wearing the rags of a beggar took advantage of the diversion to dip his hand into his neighbour's purse. A woman near her cried her wares.
Apples and oranges here. Oranges from Seville.
A thin man wearing unadorned black doublet and hose and the smallest possible white ruff was waiting for her at her store. He looked like a Puritan, and her first thought was to tell him she had no theological books. Or he might be a spy from the Privy Council, come to make sure that everything she sold had been authorised and licensed. Whoever he was, she wanted no part of him.
What book do you need? She asked.
No book,
he said.
Are you Alice Wood?
I?
Have you a son?
I had a son, she said cautiously.
No one had mentioned Arthur to her for so long, she had almost grown used to thinking of him as dead.
And where might he be now?
I don't know. Who are you? And why do you question me like this?
He took a half crown from his purse.
I'll give you this for any information you might have.
She looked at the coin.
It looks counterfeit, she said.
Aye,
he said,
smiling strangely. He put the coin back in his purse.
Beware the false coin and the false man. Beware the moon, counterfeit of the sun.
Who are you?
One who seeks the truth.
Then seek it somewhere else, or stop talking in riddles, she said, suddenly angry. If you know something about my son, I would like to hear it. And if not, go back to Bedlam where you came from. Does he owe you money?
Nay, we owe him, and more than money.
Alice watched him as he left the churchyard and thought of Arthur. She had been old when he was born, nearly 30, and he had been their only child. From the beginning, he had been a moody boy, sometimes quiet, sometimes talking about nonsense for hours on end. He had never played with the other children, and despite the fact that his father was a bookseller, he had never learned to read. Yet he had only to hear a song once to remember it, and when he was young, John used to ask him to sing for the customers who wanted to buy a ballad sheet. As he grew older, he began to leave the churchyard for hours, sometimes for days. Finally, he had left and not come back. She used to ask the poets and pamphleteers who came to talk to her and John if they had seen him, but no one had. She thought he must be dead, of some illness, like John. Or killed in a brawl. Near her, a young gallant was looking around anxiously, probably trying to find someone to dine with before the day ended, and he had to go home hungry. She smelled horse dung and the perfume and sweat of the close-parked crowd. Someone laughed loudly, and she followed the sound, hoping for a distraction. As if the thought of the pamphleteers had conjured them up, she saw Thomas Nash and fat Henry Chettle coming toward her. Swerving wide to avoid a suspected cutpurse. Good day, masters, she said, smiling a little to see them.
Good day, Mistress Wood, Thomas said. How are my bookselling?
Well enough.
Well enough for you, perhaps. You have other books to sell, but I must make up a new pamphlet or poem or play every few months, or starve.
Do you think so? You always do well.
It would take a new battle with the Armada, and Queen Elizabeth herself riding to St. Paul's to proclaim victory, for anyone to set foot in this churchyard and buy a book again. Forgive me, but it takes only one bad pamphlet to raise a damp enough to poison the entire place. You wouldn't credit the books they sell here. Richard Harvey's, for one.
Hi. I saw your attack on him in the new manuscript you gave me. I thought perhaps you might take that out. It could offend the man.
Offend him? And what's that to me?
He would feel he had to give you an answer.
Aye, let him, and I'll answer him in kind. We'll have more sport than an afternoon's bear baiting.
But it's such a paltry thing. You would be wasting your talent if you spent it on nothing but the Harveys. There is so much you could write about.
And I will, too. I could take up a pamphlet about your blue eyes, about that apple Chettle's eating.
Listen, I must ask you something. The young man looked as if he were about to go on, as if only her question prevented him from improvising for another hour.
Aye?
Have you heard any word of Arthur?
Your son? You've asked us before.
Aye, but a man's been around asking about him.
What sort of man?
A man all dressed in black. He had the look of a Puritan about him.
A Puritan? You want to stay away from that sort.
Then you haven't seen Arthur, or heard any news of him?
Nay.
She wondered if he was telling the truth. She liked the young men who visited her, but they seemed very much like the plays they wrote. Glorious and fantastical, but not really fit for daily life. They all thought, or seemed to think, that they needn't work for a living, that their books and plays would earn them enough to live on. And she wondered where on earth they had gotten this extraordinary idea. Look at Tom Nash now, she thought. Lacking nourishment, prone to illness every few months, sometimes unable even to pay his rent. He looked years younger than he actually was, as if he were a foundling. Even his pale, watery hair seemed to proclaim his straits, as if it had once been a more robust colour, and he couldn't seem to grow a beard.
He had on patched and stained clothes, and his newfangled falling collar, worn in place of a ruff, exposed his stark collarbones, thick as thumbs. But they were all of them too thin, all except Chettle, and he looked as unhealthy as the rest. How did they survive? Whenever she saw one of them, she wanted to take him aside and tell him to learn a trade before it was too late.
Well, we must be going, Thomas said. Robert Green forced a bailiff who came to arrest him to eat his citation, wax and all, and we have to see about his bail.
Did he really? She had to laugh.
Do you doubt my word? And served it to him very handsomely, too, on a fine pewter plate.
She was still laughing as they left, though in truth she was a little appalled. They all seemed to have this streak of cruelty in their makeup, even among themselves. Would they tell her if they found Arthur? Or would they think it was amusing to keep the news from her? It was almost dusk, the shadow of the churchyard walls falling across a few of the nearer stalls before she found time to talk to George. They went to the cook shop on the corner for supper, and as they sat eating mutton and drinking small beer, she asked him, Did you see that man in black who came to speak with me?
Nay, I told you. I was busy all day.
He asked me about my son.
It's not good for you to think too much of Arthur. You've said it yourself. He's probably dead.
The man I talked to thought him still alive. He asked for news of him.
Who was he?
I never saw him before. I was hoping you knew. And George, it was so strange. He offered me a coin for information, but the coin looked counterfeit, and when I told him so, he smiled, as if he had set me some sort of test. And his smile, I didn't like it. Not at all.
Did he threaten you?
Threaten? Nay, but he seemed, I don't know, intent on something. Almost as if he burned with a fever.
Promise me you'll tell me if he comes back.
I will, but truly I think he's a harmless madman, like the unfortunates who come into the churchyard at times. I doubt he'll be back.
This news worries me, Alice. It's not good for you to live alone, without a man. He would not have dared to trouble you if I had been there.
I do well enough.
How are your books selling?
Not badly.
But not well, either. You would have done better to have sold me your husband's business after he died. I thought that the best course then, and it seems that way to me still.
And how would I have gotten my livelihood?
Why, use the money I would have given you. And the stationer's fund takes care of widows. You know that.
And when your money was gone, the stationers would have given me very little.
Why do you talk that way, as if I had made you a miserly offer? I would have been quite generous.
I did not want to sell the shop, no more than I want to sell it now. John would have wanted me to keep it.
But you knew so little about bookselling.
I learn more about it every day. I just bought another manuscript from Thomas Nash.
Nash? Who is he?
A young man my husband knew. His pamphlets sell well.
But how long and how well can you live on one writer's pamphlets? I cannot understand why you must be so stubborn.
I enjoy living the way I do.
But it's wrong. Don't you see that? A woman must have a man above to guide her, just as a country must have a sovereign.
The country does quite well with a woman to guide it.
Ah, but she was appointed by God.
I did not come to supper with you to argue theology, George.
I only tell you what any man in the churchyard would say.
I know too well what they would say. Tell me something else, something only George would say. You were my friend, the one I turned to after John's death. Tell me about... Oh, the election we're about to have. Who do you think the booksellers would choose as masters of the stationer's company? After supper, George insisted on accompanying her home. The moon, just waning from the full, washed the streets with silver. The churchyard lay empty and silent under its light. The square tower of St. Paul's bulking against the night sky. By a strange trick, the tower looked to her to be farther away than the stars.
a dark shape cut in the sphere of the night.
George steered her away from a muddy pothole in the road. He really is kind, she thought, and he truly cares about my safety. I wish he understood how hard it is to do what I've chosen to do, to continue the business that John had built up so carefully. A pleasant smell as of baking almonds came from her house. She went inside, and in the pale light from the windows managed to make out that someone had left a cooling pan of marchpane on her sideboard. I wonder who brought this, she said. It's very good of them, whoever it was. Have a piece, George.
Nay, it's late, and I must be going home.
Maybe I have a suitor.
In the dim light, she could not be certain, but it seemed to her that George scowled.
2. In the Saracen's Head in Shoreditch, on the outskirts of London, the night was just beginning. It was a dim place with no windows, lit only by the cooking fire and a few candles. Knives and daggers had scarred the tables and benches. The air stank of smoke and tobacco and stale beer, and the rushes on the floor needed freshening. In one corner, a group of men and women sang ballads and madrigals, hitting their pewter cups with knives to keep time. Across the room, Robert Green, freed on borrowed money he could not afford to pay back, was holding forth.
Nay, I counted it a trifle, an afternoon's fair diversion, he said.
He took a sip of beer and wiped his mouth on his sleeve.
The Compter is a spacious inn, compared to some of the prisons which have sheltered me.
He was older than most of the playwrights, and that combined with his stocky build, his great beard, and his mane of red-brown hair made him seem avuncular, a natural thoughty figure.
Free prison for me,
Thomas Nash said. He drew on his tobacco pipe.
I was served a rare vintage there the last time I was in.
Thomas Kidd looked between the two men as if trying to decide if they were jesting. He had heard otherwise, that men had died or disappeared in London's prisons, killed by starvation or disease or other prisoners. He was a very serious-looking young man, with a black curly beard and a pale face that, as Tom Nash had once said, looked like unbaked bread dough. Unlike the other two, he had not gone to either Cambridge or Oxford, and he seemed to feel very keenly that he was in some sense their inferior. There was a fourth man sitting by the three of them, but whether he wanted to take part in their conversation, or was even listening to it, none of the others could say. He had red-gold hair, and his eyes were an astonishing green, surrounded by dark, almost black lashes. They had seen him in the tavern before. He never seemed to drink anything, or indeed to have any money, but by the end of the night he would appear as drunk as the rest of them.
When were you in Fleet Prison?
Tom Kidd said finally, as if unable to keep silent any longer.
Many a man of honour has sailed in that fleet,
Tom Nash said, grinning at him.
Do you tell me that the Queen has never offered you lodgings in one of her pleasure houses? Well, of course not. What, never been to the university and never been to prison? Tell me, Tom, what have you been doing with your life? It's a sad case when our brightest playwrights know nothing at all about the world they portray on stage. I know enough,
Tom Kidd said. He wondered if Nash meant what he said about brightest playwrights, or if he was just talking to himself talk, or if he was having another joke at Kidd's expense. A year ago, Nash had attacked him in print, and Kidd had decided never to return to the tavern, never to drink with such men again. But there was something about the university wits that kept him coming back, like a poor beggar to a fire. Their very profligacy seemed to blaze like a beacon. Someday they would be consumed by it. Not he, though, Kidd thought. He was far too prudent.
But this day I have made a vow, Robert Green said, never to return to debtor's prison. You see before you a changed man. I remember you have sworn such oaths before, Robin, Tom Nash said. There is not a dog under the table that would believe you. You would do well to make such a vow yourself, my young friend, Robert said. Give over your intemperate ways, Quit this foolish, rancorous feud you have with Richard Harvey. Harvey?
Tom Nash said, his beer halfway to his mouth.
That gross-brained idiot. He attacked you first, and in print too. How can you have forgotten it? He said you were not fit to pass judgment on other writers. And the answer you gave him in your pamphlet was not enough, I fear. It's a matter of honor, Robin. I have struck out that part of my pamphlet. It will not go to press the way you saw it. I tell you, I have changed. As of this day, I vow never to owe any man money, never to drink immoderately, never to do anything by word or deed that would show me not to be one of the most civil of Her Majesty's subjects. Never to visit M of Hollywell Street? Tom Nash asked.
Robert turned to him angrily. But at that moment, the fourth man, who until then had said nothing, spoke up.
You may do all of those things, he said. I forgive you.
You? Tom Nash said.
And who are you? Do you not know your king?
The light of one of the candles flared up suddenly, and the man's shadow on the wall grew huge. The shadow stilled Nash's merriment for a moment. A serving woman called an order to the tavern's host, sounding loud in the silence, and someone laughed and was hushed. Then the candle guttered and died, and Tom laughed.
Oh, the king! And are you Elizabeth's son? Or Mary's? Mary? Look at this fellow, Nash said, gesturing at the other two. There's good sport here.
He turned to the young man.
Have you never heard of bloody Queen Mary, who ruled in our parents' time? Surely you had a mother to tell you stories of the old bad queen?
The young man looked confused.
Aye, I remember. Good. He remembers his mother. A brave start. And your father? But perhaps that's a more difficult question. Let him be,
Tom Kidd said.
He's lost his wits, can't you tell? My father,
the young man said.
I don't...
Nash laughed, but Robert Green had not finished with his earlier conversation, and now he turned to his friend.
Think about what I said, Tom. Don't let your pamphlet be printed as it is now, with the attack on Richard Harvey. And why shouldn't I? Do you think I'm afraid of anything the Harveys might say? Let them answer me. They're all of them pompous asses. I remember Kit Marlowe said to me once, are you still keeping company with that man? Known to the world for an arrant atheist,
Robert said.
Where is he?
Tom Kidd asked.
I haven't seen him in London for several weeks. He comes and goes as he pleases. But on what errands? Errands? No one knows.
A few streets away, in the tavern at the sign of the Black Boar, Christopher Marlowe sat and listened to an agent of the Queen. The currency exchanged at the Boar was intelligence, knowledge true and false, and so the place stayed silent, ill-lit, remote from the hustle and bustle of London. At one table sat a soldier who had done good service in France a dozen years ago and who waited to be taken on for any trifling task again. At another, Christopher recognized a man who would work for anyone, anywhere, who had once sold state secrets three times over to the French, Spanish, and English. A sour smell of old beer and false hopes lingered in the air. Christopher took out his tobacco pipe and lifted the candle close to light it. Whenever he saw Robert Polley, he always wondered at how suited the man was for his trade. Look at him once and you wouldn't want to look at him again. His features were so ordinary as to turn him almost invisible. Average height, sandy hair, nondescript face. Only his eyes, which were a pale watery blue, made him stand out in a crowd.
Did you get the book I asked for?
Robert Polley asked.
Aye.
Christopher passed a slender volume to the other man, glancing again at the tide. Being a true history of the nobility of England, with an especial account of the royal families.
I suppose you read it,
Robert said dryly. Christopher pushed back his long auburn hair,
the same fashionable colour as the Queen's, but much thicker, nearly unmanageable, and looked at Robert. His eyes were a light brown, and he wore a gold ring in one ear.
Of course I read it. Books aren't that easy to come by. I couldn't afford to pass this one up. I thought it interesting, if a little dry. I don't pay you for your opinions. You are to finish the tasks I give you. No more.
Christopher nodded. He had had to search through the yard at Paul's and beyond to find someone who had the book for sale. When he had looked through it, he had seen no publisher on the title page. It had been printed illegally by someone without a license from the Privy Council. He guessed that Robert was building a case against the publisher who had stated that Elizabeth had no right to the throne. Robert's silence on the matter galled him. The other man had once told Christopher that he traded in information, and information had to be hoarded to drive its value upward. To goad him into speaking, Christopher said,
"The man who sold me the book made some interesting points. He told me, 'Don't tell me you spoke to him.' Of course I spoke to him. If I'm to buy a book, I want to know what it's about. After all, he's a traitor to the Queen. When we find the publisher, we'll take this man for questioning as well. Good God, you could have been overheard. You could have been arrested for treason. Don't do anything like that again." "If I was arrested for treason, you would have spoken up for me. Would I?"
Robert's eyes glistened in the candlelight. He smiled, revealing a row of rotten teeth.
"Don't be too certain. I'm wondering how much I can trust you, after all. The last time I sent you on an errand, I heard strange news about you."
"News?"
"Aye, news. My informant told me your opinions are quite unorthodox, and that you show no fear of spreading them abroad. Don't think that because you work for me, the Privy Council will protect you. If you're caught, I'll be lucky to get away with my neck intact."
Christopher waited. Robert would not have sent for him to read him a lecture, after all. At a neighbouring table, he heard someone say, whispering,
5,000 soldiers, and whatever money he can raise."
Finally, the other man leaned forward.
"There are rumours,"
Robert said, lowering his voice. As always, he gave out no names. He would never say more than,
"I have heard,"
or,
"My informants tell me,"
or,
"There are rumours." "Rumours? You know from this book that some in London are speaking of an heir to the throne. Lately, these stories have multiplied. Folks say now that there is a man who has come to save his country in time of need, or some such nonsense."
"Who says this?"
"Many people. I'm surprised you haven't heard them. Once they start on their fantasies, these legends, they will talk of nothing else."
"What sort of legends?"
"How should I know? Dreams and fables, that's your province. But all their talk is of the return of kings. In my opinion, their mood is dangerous. Very dangerous. Do you think there is any truth to it? That a man should walk out of legend? That someone is abroad, speaking to people in the language of the old stories, claiming kinship with the heroes of antiquity?"
"Perhaps.
If there is, he will be brought in and questioned. And what am I to do about it?"
"You are to watch for him,"
Robert said.
"You go to taverns, don't you? That's where our informers have seen him."
Christopher nodded. Taverns, he thought. Doubtless the man's a poor drunk who doesn't realise what he's saying. But any errand from Robert Pulley was welcome. Writing for the stage, even writing plays as successful as his were, paid very little. He needed the spy work Robert gave him to stay alive in London. Robert stood.
"Where will you go now?"
he asked.
"Taverns,"
Christopher said, smiling slightly.
"I'm anxious to begin work."
"Good. I'll walk with you."
They left the Black Boar together. Robert had never wanted to walk with him before. The other man had always taken care not to be seen with him out of doors. Was Robert checking up on him? He hadn't intended to carry out the agent's task that night, to be truthful. Instead, he planned to go to the Saracen's Head and see if Green had managed to escape prison once again. They followed the twisted skein of the streets. The white moon shone above them, too high now to cast much light. Footsteps sounded in the dark street, and Christopher looked back over his shoulder out of habit. Few honest people walked abroad so late at night. He could see no one.
Did you hear that? What?
Robert asked.
I heard nothing. Someone behind us.
Robert turned.
Are you certain? Nay, I must have imagined it.
A few moments later, the footsteps came again. This time when he looked back, Christopher saw a young man slipping into a doorway.
There is someone,
he said softly. He put his hand to the dagger at his back.
And I saw him before, watching us at the Black Boar. He's been following us.
Any of his friends would have dismissed his fear as an idle fancy, but Polly lived and breathed in the medium of plots and conspiracies. The agent stopped and stared back into the shadowy street.
Nay, there's no one there,
he said,
and it's too dark to see anyone, let alone recognize a man from the boar. I tell you, I saw him,
Christopher said. A second man turned into the street and began to run toward them. He stopped at the doorway Christopher had seen and gave a loud cry. Christopher and Robert moved back into the shadows of the street. The man in the doorway shouted,
You! I thought...
Then they both heard the unmistakable sound of steel being scraped against steel as the second man drew his dagger. The man in the doorway moved out into the street. He had not drawn his dagger, probably, Christopher thought. He had not gotten over the shock of being challenged by a man he obviously knew. The other man struck. Finally, the first man seemed to rouse himself. He jumped back, but his opponent had managed to cut deeply into his arm. He drew his dagger slowly, as if tussled. Now Robert and Christopher could see blood welling from the man's sleeve, a flat black against the white of the cloth. The second man moved forward to attack again, and the first tried to parry, slashing out in front of him where his opponent slipped deftly to the right. The first man turned quickly, but it was too late. The second man's dagger came up under him. He twisted to get away. The second man thrust the dagger forward into the other's chest. The first man fell slowly to the ground, a look more of surprise than fear on his face. His opponent bent over him. Robert and Christopher saw the dying man try to speak.
Who? We should leave, Robert said. Quickly, the watch will come, and they'll take us to prison before we can explain ourselves. Nay,
Christopher said urgently.
He was following us. What did he want? Who is the other man?
The second man looked up sharply. Had he heard them? The man looked back once at his opponent and then ran off down the street. Christopher moved as if to follow, but Robert held him back.
It's none of our concern, Robert said. Let's go. Of course it's our concern. Who was he?
But it was already too late. The man had gone, and perhaps Robert was right. The watch would certainly come to take them to prison if they stayed. Last year he had gone to Newgate Prison because a friend of his had killed a man in a duel, and he had no wish to repeat that experience.
Our business is with the man I mentioned, the one who claims to be king,
Robert said. He had composed himself and now looked the way Christopher remembered him, controlled, untouchable by any calamity. But for a moment, Christopher had seen a different side of the man, had seen him frightened. Now, watching him, he knew that something subtle had changed between them. Whatever it was, it would not soon be forgotten by either one. He walked home slowly, all thoughts of the Saracen's Head forgotten. 3. That night, the folk who had been exiled to London met in Finsbury Field. To the north, the field's three great windmills turned, making a doleful sound like a man groaning. During the day, laundresses used the place to dry their clothes, and marksmen aimed their arrows at large paper heads painted like Turks,
but at night, the exile shared the field only with a few beggars and vagabonds. It was the work of a moment to cast a glamour over these homeless men and women, and so render themselves invisible. But one of the men, driven mad by his long exposure to the elements, swore ever after that he had seen a tiny creature with wings like spiderwebs. "Spring comes on apace, and we are no closer to finding the babe," the queen said.
"He is here in the city, though," a horned man said. "I can feel him."
"Others have been asking for him," another said. "I have heard them."
"We must get to him first," the queen said, "else all is lost."
She looked around her at the open space of the field, trying to find something that reminded her of home. They had no gift for planning, she knew that. And here in this strange place, they had become confused, thrown off balance. The people around them knew how to plot great stratagems, how to lay plans that came to fruition years later. She did not like to think of what would happen if they found the babe first. "A great change is coming," said one who had not spoken before, the smallest of them. She had roused from where she lay, nestled in the brownie's palm, and now she spread her silken wings. Everyone quieted to hear her. "This world and all we have known will pass away. Trees and stone, wind and rain will be as naught. It will be a world of artifice, of vast gears interlocking in one enormous mechanism."
The windmill sighed, turning.
The queen felt as if she had just heard their doom pronounced.
"Will there be a place for us?" she asked.
But the smallest one's sister was singing now, and by custom they could not interrupt her. "Change and go, change and go," she sang. "Twirl your pot. Now change and go." The smallest one caught her sister's fancy and sang with her. They rose, laughing, and skittered off into the night air like leaves. There would be no more prophecies. Already the more giddy of the folk had joined in a circle to play and spin in their ancient dance. The queen looked up at the moon for comfort, but it was smudged and nearly hidden by the fog. She felt very small and alone, and the time left to them was almost gone. Alice was wise enough not to look too closely at the gifts of food left by her admirer, at the scrubbed hearth and mended clothes. Over the weeks she had become used to such things, almost dependent on them. The day never seemed long enough for everything she had to do, and, unlike most of the stationers, she had no wife to cook and clean for her. Edward Blunt had once suggested she find an apprentice, but none of the men eager to learn the bookseller's trade had seemed willing to take orders from a woman. Often they would ask to speak to her husband when they applied for a job. And while she could let that go, understanding their confusion, she never felt that they would in time come to think of her as an employer. She'd kept the young assistant John had hired, but he was a little simple, unable to learn any but the easiest tasks. So when she came out into her kitchen and did not see her usual breakfast of bread and beer, she felt disappointed. Perhaps she thought she had offended in some way. Then she saw something move near the hearth. It was of medium height and man-shaped, though she would have wagered her soul it was not a man. Fur, the colour of nutmeg, covered everything but its broad-seamed face. Its ears were pointed, and it wore a small red cap shaped like a triangle. Its feet. But some ancient superstition kept her from looking at the feet. She was afraid that she would find them hoofed. The thing was asleep, she saw now, and she stepped back, not wanting to wake it. Almost she made the sign of the cross, the way her mother used to do when she was frightened or startled. It stirred and opened its eyes. They were a clear brown, like cow dung, and somehow strangely comforting.
"Ho!" it said. "What in rock? What a night we had together in the fields. I met a screech owl coming home."
Hearing it speak brought her out of her daze. She should run, get help, call George or Edward. But her movement seemed to frighten it, as if it suddenly recalled who and what she was. It curled back toward the hearth, trying to hide. Amazed at the thought that it might be as fearful as she was, she stopped and held out her hand. Are you the one I should thank for the labour done here?
No,
it said. The old women in her village had told stories of such a creature, she remembered now. It would come into your home and do your work, milk your cows and churn your butter, but on no account should you thank it. If you did, it would leave. She nodded to it, trying to be matter-of-fact. Good day to you then, she said, and turned and left. The old woman had called the man a brownie. They had been wise, but Alice thought she had a friend who was wiser. She would have to seek out Marjorie and tell her what happened. It had been too long since her last visit. As she went from her house to the churchyard, she smiled to think of her friend. Marjorie wore a ring on every finger, each with a different jewel, and had a drop of stone at her ear, like a man's, and her long black hair was unfettered by any cap. She lived in a crowded cottage out beyond the city walls. Inside the cottage, a fine patina of cat fur lay over everything, and the smell of tobacco smoke hung in the air. For Marjorie also smoked like a man. Aye, certainly, Marjorie would know what to do. Paul's was filled with people as always, but at noon the crowd emptied out to hear a proclamation read on Cheapside Street. She closed her store and went over to talk to George.
Care to take your dinner with me?
He asked. Of course, she said. As they walked together, she wondered if she should tell George about the brownie. But before she could decide, he said,
I have something important to ask you.
Aye? They reached the cook shop, and he directed her to one of the tables. She could not remember ever seeing him so solemn.
I have given much thought to what I am about to say,
he said as they sat down.
As I have told you, I do not believe it is right for a woman to live alone. And I care for you, Alice, and will always wish you well. I wonder if, well, if you would marry me.
Marry?
Aye. Is it such a surprise then? I had thought we were friends.
Aye, we are, but marriage. I had not looked to marry again.
Truly, I believe you could do no better than to marry me, immodest though it sounds to say. We have known each other a long time, and I believe our shops would thrive together. You have certain copyrights and the monopoly on the playbills. Do you think I speak in jest, then?
He asked, but she had started to laugh. Oh, George, she said. My dear, sweet friend George. I am sorry, but you make it sound so much like a trade agreement.
Aye, and so it is, partly. I don't like to see you struggling for want of knowledge of the stationer's craft. It is as I have said. I care for you. By marrying you, I can watch over you. I can see that you have everything you need.
I'm sorry, George, but I do not think that I am ready to marry.
You needn't give me an answer so soon. I know you will have to think about it. When you are ready...
I have told you. I'm not ready to marry again. But I thank you very much for your concern. He moved back a little, away from her. Something happened to his face. It seemed to harden slightly, to become less pliant. Was he angry with her? But surely he would want her to speak her mind on something so important. I'm like the queen in this, she said. I do not think I will ever marry again.
And now you compare yourself to the queen? He said. Really? You have got above yourself. Perhaps you would like some jewels for your gown, or ladies-in-waiting?
Please, this doesn't become you.
It's not I who have declared myself England's new sovereign.
That was but an example.
A treasonous example. And blasphemous too. Only God can appoint a monarch.
Now you're being foolish. I said only that I am like the queen in this one thing.
The queen is free to choose in this matter because she has been appointed by God. We who are her subjects cannot judge her actions. You are only a woman, chosen by no one. It's not right for you to remain unmarried.
If that's all you have to say to me, she said, then I'll go back to the churchyard. Good day. By the time she had shouldered her way through the crowd to her station, she wondered if she had made the right decision. George had been right. He could teach her much about the stationer's trade. And it was hard being a woman and living alone. George could help there, too.
Have you heard ill news? Edward Blunt said as she opened her store. You look melancholy.
I feel well enough, she said, not quite sure if she lied or not. Only, George has asked me to marry him.
And do you want to marry George?
I don't know. I don't think so.
Well then,
he said, as if that settled the matter. She would have talked longer with him, but at that moment a man came by asking for a copy of Holinshed's Chronicles, and by the time she had directed him to the right store, Edward was deep in conversation. Could it be as simple as Edward made it seem? She didn't think so. She thought that George might end their friendship because she preferred to live alone. And she was loath to give up one of the few friends she had made in the churchyard. And perhaps it went deeper than that. Perhaps she'd struck at his pride. Whatever happened, she knew she could not go back to the old comfort that had existed between them. She would only go on as best she could, the way she had gone on after John died. Edward was motioning her over to his store, and when she came he indicated the man he had been talking to.
This is Walter James, he said, the new member of our company.
Membership in the stationer's company was limited to 53 people. She found herself angry that they had never elected a woman. It would have been good to have someone in the churchyard she could open her heart to. But had any woman ever applied for membership? She felt in a foul mood today. Edward had been wrong. The humour that possessed her was not melancholic, but choleric. She nodded to Walter James, not feeling civil enough to speak. He was small and thin and seemed to be put together out of knobs. Nose, chin, Adam's apple, knuckles. His straight brown hair made a sharp angle across his forehead. She thought he was about 50, her age.
As I was telling Master Blunt, I've changed my profession late in life, he said. I ran an inn before I learned the bookseller's trade.
She felt surprised. She had never known anyone besides herself to learn a new trade at so late an age.
So you must come to my aid if I falter in my new profession, he said.
Was he having a jest at her expense? No one had ever asked for her help before. But he was smiling winningly at her, and she realized that he had not intended to joke. A flatterer, she thought. She would have to watch out for his cousining ways. George finished his dinner and headed back to his store. Now that Alice had gone, he felt more puzzled than angry. Why had she refused his suit to her? She would not get a better one. And he knew how hard it was for her to live alone. Did she reject him only because his offer had more of commerce in it than of love? But he felt that great things could come from a marriage of their two stalls. He had never understood why poets and ballad makers wrote and sang so much about love. He had been in love once, as a youth, and he hadn't liked it. It had made him feel as if he were in the grip of a powerful illness, and since that time he had avoided most strong feeling, the way his fellow Londoners avoided the plague. He would ask her again, he decided. Surely she would not be so self-willed as to refuse him a second time. A man waited by his stall.
How may I help you? He asked. You should ask. Rather, how it is that I may help you,
the man said.
I have something I think you will want.
And what is that?
You wish to win a lady's favour. What I have, how do you know that?
George asked, hearing his private life talked of in this manner threw him off balance. But his surprise quickly gave way to anger.
Who are you? My name is Anthony Drury. How I learned your secrets is of no importance. It is of importance to me. I won't have men sniffing around my affairs, listening to conversations that don't concern them. I don't come by my information that way. Someday you may be allowed to know how I learned about your desires, but not today. What I have is a way to win her. How?
George asked, interested in spite of himself.
Ah,
Anthony said.
It's not so easy. Surely you've seen the new play where a man makes a bargain with the devil? I am no devil, but like him, I will not give away my wares for nothing. I don't go to plays, and I will not traffic with the devil. Good. That shows a serious mind. Aye, indeed, I have a serious mind, and I am of a mind not to like what I am hearing. Talk of the devil, of information ill-gotten. Nay, wait a moment. Think of your lady, yielding to you, eager to do your bidding. She has refused you once, but no longer. Whatever you command her to do will be done. This smells of the spirit world. I'm not so foolish, my friend. What I offer you has a sound basis in the theory of medicine. I can make you up a potion that will put her completely under your sway. Can this be? Certainly. Each of us is influenced by the four humors. Blood, phlegm, yellow bile, and black bile. And this influence extends not just to our bodies, but to our minds as well. An excess of some of the humors, a lack of others, and she will dance to any song you choose to play. And what do you want in return? In return? Only a trifle. I would like you to discover what became of her son.
This must be Alice's man in black, George thought, realizing it at that moment. He wore a doublet and hose of dark brown today. But like the man Alice spoke of, he had the look of someone with an intense purpose about him.
Why?
He asked.
It is not part of our bargain that you ask questions, nor that I answer them. Only that you tell me if you agree or no.
I'll have to consider it, George said slowly. Come back tomorrow for your answer.
Tomorrow, then.
Good day.
George stood at his store and watched him thoughtfully. Then the crowd moved between him and the strange man, and he turned back to his books. By evening, he was still thinking about the offer. He remembered one thing the man had said clearer than the rest.
She will dance to any song you choose to play.
The idea of Alice dancing for him, and the larger idea of her doing his bidding, giving over her willful ways, was intensely pleasing to him. And what was her son to him in any case? The boy was probably dead, just as he had said to Alice in the cookshop. He would agree to the offer, he thought. By the time Anthony realized that Arthur had disappeared, George and Alice would be married. Alice left the churchyard early and made her way slowly home. The house had been aired out, she saw, but even that failed to please her. She sat at the stool near the hearth and looked out her kitchen window. The light fell on the houses opposite, turning them pink, then red, and finally violet grey, charcoal grey, black. The house filled up with darkness. She was thinking of John. One day he had come home, thrown his cloak down on the bench, and gone straight to bed.
I feel poorly,
he'd said, and that was how it had started, just those three words. She'd nursed him for a day and a half. The hard lumps had appeared under his armpits, but there had been little plague in London that season, and she had refused to think about what the swelling might mean. Plague was something that happened to other people. After he died, she got up and wandered through their house. She had not left his bedside for hours, and she was surprised to see that light still shone outside, that people still went about their business. His cloak lay where he had dropped it, and it was only then, realizing that he would never pick it up and wear it again, never go off singing to work, that she began to understand what had happened to her. From now on, she thought, I'll always be alone. What would John think if he could see her now? Would he urge her to accept George's offer? She was not even sure he would have wanted her to continue at his store, but she had been unable to think of what else to do with her life, how to fill up the days and months without him. And how else was she to get her livelihood? She and John had grown up in neighbouring towns in the countryside around Cambridge and had met at a harvest festival. She'd known him by sight, of course, but she had never really been aware of him before then. That day, she saw him throw Barker's head in laughter, and something changed within her. She understood that she wanted that laughter, that energy, for herself. That she could very easily be in love with him. She chased him with a determination she'd never given to anything else. And when they married, she knew that she loved him more than he loved her. But by the time he died, she had the satisfaction of knowing that he'd come to love her deeply. And she knew, too, that marriage had turned out to be far more than merely possessing another person. An adventure she could not have guessed at observing it from the outside. John's father had apprenticed him to a blacksmith, but he'd felt the work didn't suit him. Instead, he'd spent his time watching the printers in Cambridge, the only place in England besides Oxford and London granted a license from the Queen to print books. One day he'd come home and told her to park. She had just set Arthur in his court, and the excitement in his voice made her turn around to face him.
"We're going to London," he said. "One of the printers wants to sell his books in the city, and he's agreed to take me on as an apprentice."
That had been how long ago? If Arthur had been a baby, then at least 20 years had passed. So much had changed. So much had stayed the same. John had prospered as a publisher and bookseller. He'd a knack for knowing which subjects would catch the public's fancy, and then he had been granted the monopoly to print playbills. But she had made few friends in the city, most of them other stationers, who had only wanted to talk business with her husband. And then Arthur had run off, and John had died. What would John think if he could see her now?
"Stop pitying yourself," he would say sternly. "Get up. There's things to be done. You're on your own now, so make the best of it."
She stood. A noise from the doorway made her turn around. She wasn't alone. The brownie came into the room, lighting candles as it went. It moved closer and she nearly barked away, but she could tell that it wanted something from her.
"Come," it said. "The revels have begun."
It looked eager, expectant.
"What? Come with me. By tree and stone, by wind and rain, you'll not get another chance like this one. No, not if you live as long as my queen."
"Chance?" She felt slow, witless.
"To join us. Dance with us." Of course you do. It's given to few mortals to see our celebrations. You'll curse yourself all your days if you don't come with me now."
He smiled engagingly. He looked a little like Arthur had as a child, before Arthur had grown so strange. And when had she started thinking of the creature as he? She realized she was smiling too.
"You looked unhappy," he said. "It would do you good to get outside these walls, this prison. You can't think clearly, packed in closely like this."
She found she couldn't resist him. She nodded slowly.
"I'll come with you." "Wonderful."
He moved closer, and this time she did back away, afraid.
"Hold,"
he said, and breathed on her left eye.
"What was that?" she asked. "A change."
He took hold of her hand, and she allowed herself to be led into the darkened streets. As they passed a cobweb on her wall, she thought she saw something glimmering, shining like a jewel.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.